And welcome to this session. The session is titled Discovering Functional Treasures in Idiomatic Brewing. So mostly it's functional programming in brewing. So before I get started, I would like to understand how many of you know Java here? How many of you know Groovy? Great. Scala or any other? Great. So let's get started. My name is Naresha, and I work for a company called Entelechy Solutions. Functional programming. Since all of you are already in functional programming conference, I'm sure you do care about functional programming. And after attending several good talks today, I'm sure you are convinced why you should use functional programming or what are the benefits of using functional programming. So I'm not going to talk on that. So let's jump into Groovy. What's Groovy? Groovy is a language on JVM, wherein Groovy code gets compiled into JVM bytecode, and then it runs on JVM. Whenever a programming language is designed, they usually start with some goals in mind. So one of them is a paradigm, whether it has to be functional programming, or is it procedural, or is it object-oriented, so and so. Let's see what does Groovy do. Groovy is one of those, or I could say, the programming language on JVM, which is closest to Java in terms of syntax. Typically, you can put a copy of Java program into Groovy program and compile it as a Groovy code, and you could run it, except the recent additions of Lambda expression syntax. But there could be some a difference during runtime. That's very much possible. So I can say I have a for loop in Java. I can copy paste into Groovy and I could run it. So you could do imperative programming to some extent. Groovy will not prevent you from doing that. So in the beginning, people are, since the language doesn't prevent, people may go and do imperative programming. So we could say Groovy is an imperative programming language. Maybe. But being functional programmers, we know that imperative isn't a good thing, right? Imperative things are evil. And recently, we celebrated Dasara or Dashera, and we know what we do with the evil things. What do we do? Sorry? Yeah. So let's burn the evil things. Now, we need to welcome some good things. So since Diwali is nearby, let's welcome good things in that way. Groovy is a dynamic language with functional flavor. So that has been my journey. Let's go back to 2003 and see what did the creator of Groovy talked about Groovy. Say, James Strachan was the one who created Groovy. So his idea was mainly to bring in developer productivity to to the programmers or developers who program on JVM, because all of you know the productivity in Java language is very low. It takes a lot of code to do even the simplest of the things. That is a link to his blog. So that's how it got started. Prerequisites are very simple. There are two prerequisites here to understand this session. First one, you need to know how to define a function in Groovy. And second one is how to call a function Groovy. So here is an example where you could say, I have a function called say hello, and I'm going to call that, which is just going to print. So I hope that's very straightforward. Now, what are we going to do in this session? What is the approach? One of the approach could be that I articulate the concepts of functional programming or the functional programming ideas, then take you through working examples which shows how to apply them in Groovy. That's one approach. But I started using functional programming in Groovy without even bothering whether I'm doing functional programming. Maybe I didn't even know that I'm doing functional programming. My idea was to move from the complex world of imperative programming towards a simple programming model that Groovy provides through its constructs. So, one fine day when I started looking around my code, I realized that, there are a lot of functional concepts being applied in Groovy. That's the path which I traveled. So I'm going to take the same approach. We will start with the imperative approach. We will try to move towards simple code by moving towards idiomatic Groovy. And at that time, we will turn back and see what functional programming concepts did we use. So let's start our journey. First thing we need to know is about closures. So you could see a block of code there within a pair of braces, which just says println hello, which is being assigned to a variable called ish. Since Groovy is a dynamically typed language, I really don't have to specify the type there. We could say def. And you could call a closure in a very similar way you would call a function. Right. So that would make me to think that I'm just calling this block without passing any parameters. But that's not quite true. Look at this example. I'm passing a parameter called Raj here to the closure wish friend. And I'm printing hello followed by $it. So I'm referring to a variable called it. So where did it come? So by default, closure takes a single argument, and the default name is it. Just imagine what would happen if your English teacher looks at this code. You are referring to Raj as it. I don't know if your friend Raj would be happy or not, but definitely your English teacher would be angry, right? We don't want to get into do that. So let's give our own name to that. I say the parameter name is two, and instead of $it, I now refer by $2. Let's go ahead and see how you could define a no argument closure. You just put a arrow without any parameter list, that will be treated as no argument closure. What if you want to write a closure which takes multiple arguments? That's going to be real simple. You provide the parameters separated by comma. So you could say, I mean, if you take a normal function in Groovy, you cannot assign it to a variable. Whereas if you take a closure, you can assign it to a variable. So you could say closures are powerful functions, which have more power than normal functions. And the pattern we saw here is we are assigning a block of code or closure to a variable. With that, we have discovered our first treasure. That's nothing but functions as values. People also refer to this as functions, in the language, functions are first class citizens. It's the same concept. It means that you can assign them to values, to variables, and then whatever you could do with variables, you could do with closures. Let's go ahead. So throughout this talk, I'll be referring to this data set. I'm using a class here just to represent a data structure, and I'll not be going to use any of the object-oriented concepts here. So I have a bunch of geeks, or I could say a list of geeks, and there are three objects, Raj, Arun, and Kumar. And I have the ages, their age, as well as the languages they know. This is what we will use throughout our session. Let's start with the first task. We want to find out those geeks who know Groovy here. Let's start with a very imperative style, wherein I pass the list geeks into the function. Then I do is I declare an empty list, call it as Groovy geeks. Then I use for loop, and whenever I see that the languages contains Groovy, I just go and append them to the list. Very simple program, mostly Java program, except that you would see that in keyword. So what's bad about this? what happens when a closure programmer looks at this and, well, why should I talk to Groovy programmers? I would want to talk to closure programmers. So get me the feature to find out all the closure programmers. At the same time, Scala programmers will say, oh, we do want to speak to our fellow Scala programmers, not just other programmers. Get me that function. At the time, we will see that Java programmers are sitting silent, so we go and ask them, hey, do you want to have this feature implemented for you? And they'll say, I know I'm busy coding. So we want to generalize this so that I can apply this to Scala programmers or closure programmers and so on. So where is the evil in this? That is one word. So simplest option is to copy paste this into multiple functions and replace Groovy with other languages, say closure. But we are all good programmers. We don't want to do that, right? Instead, what we could do is, anybody? Yeah, we could pass it as a parameter. So here is the improved version where we pass language as the parameter, which works. But the problem with this is that in this case, the comparison is just depending on one attribute language. But what if my comparison is depending on, say 10, 20 attributes, or it's a very complex logic? Then this doesn't scale well. I can go on passing parameters after parameters, 10, 20, but that really doesn't scale. So, it's the same, right? Still you have to, so this approach doesn't really scale well. So we want to think in different direction. So what do? Let's use a function called findAll provided by Groovy for collections, which takes a closure. So we saw closure previously. So here I haven't named that. I haven't assigned the closure to any variable. Instead, I have directly passed closure as a parameter. So that's the first step. Looks a little bit ugly. Whenever closure is the last parameter to a function, you can put it outside the parentheses. So that's what I have done in this case. Or you could altogether avoid parentheses since it doesn't have any other parameters apart from the closure. Let's still make it better. Let's extract it out of that function and name it as NoseGroovy, which takes geek object as a parameter and which checks if the geek contains Groovy. So this is specific to Groovy. We will slowly come back to the more generalized version of this. And I can pass this as a parameter now. The closure, I can pass it as a parameter to find geeks functional, and I can get the result. I can get the work done. So that leads to our second treasure. What is that? Higher order functions. Right. It's all good we have higher order function, but what are the real benefits of that? Let's take a strategy pattern. Say, instead of Groovy, I want to get all the geeks who know closure. So I create another closure called nose closure, and I pass it as the criteria. Simple, right? So you could compare this approach to strategy pattern in object-oriented way, where you'll have to have a common interface or have a common abstract class. Then you would implement, have multiple implementations or extending those. You would create multiple classes. A lot of boilerplate code is required, which can be avoided by using this approach. Please feel free to ask questions whenever you have. You don't have to wait till the end. Let's take command pattern. So again, I have created two closures here, say hello and say hi. I'm putting these closures in a list, and I'm using each function, which is an internal iterator, and I'm trying to invoke the command. So again, you really don't have to create classes, objects to implement command pattern. It's a real simple, and looking at that, one can clearly understand what's going on. Let's take another example. Let's just extend that command pattern. Suppose, say, you want some common functionality to be executed before the function being called, before the command, and after the function being called, Say you want to open a resource and close a resource, or say you want to create a transaction and end a transaction, or say you want to append common headers into your web service request. All such cases, you could use this execute around pattern in a real simple way using functional approach. Now, we used this closure previously. We have two closure. What's not so good about this? Exactly. We have violated try principle here, right? You could generalize it better. So what we do here is, let's introduce another closure wherein we call the criteria, I mean, we add another parameter called language to our closure, and the anonymous closure, what is there inside find geeks, you would call the current geek with the language that is being passed. But can we improve it further? Let's take this. The functional programming culture talks about creating more generic functionality first, and then derive specific functionalities from that, or specific functions from that, or more customizations from that. So what do we do here? We have the closure most language, which is created in the previous example. Then we create two more closures by querying. So if you look at nose language closure, it takes two parameters, geek and language. So by specifying R query, I'm fixing the rightmost parameter as Groovy, and I'm getting another closure. Similarly, I fix the rightmost parameter, that's the language, as closure, and I get another. So this is where you really promote the reuse, wherein, say, you want the combination of, you know, geek with a particular language to be used in multiple places, again, you are violating try principle. But if you use this, you can use the curried closure as a parameter to the subsequent functions. That's what we have done here in, you could see in the calls, find geeks, where we pass Groovy closure and one corresponding to closure. So that leads to the next treasure, that's curried functions or partially applying functions. Let's move ahead and take another task. In this case, we want to find out all those geeks who know Groovy, and they are at least 25 years old. Right? How do we do that? Let me create one more closure. The similar way I created for nose Groovy, I can create one for at least 25 years old, where if I check the age is greater than or equals 25. I already have find geeks function there. What if I want to give this function the features of closure? I want to make it more powerful. This situation will come in if you already have a function defined, right? So you really don't want to duplicate that code within a closure just for getting the power of closure, right? So what you could do is you could convert a method into a closure using ampersand operator. So here I say this dot and find geeks. So I would get a closure from the function find geeks. Then again, I fix the language. I mean, sorry, in this case, the criteria, and I derive, which is nose Groovy in this case, and I get find Groovy geeks. Similarly, I get find geeks at least 25 by curry. Now, what I really have to do is I call this function or closure one after another, right? In this case, I could call either of them. I could filter Groovy developers first and then filter by age, or I could filter by age first and then filter by the nose Groovy condition. Instead of taking that approach, again, if this combination you want to reuse it somewhere, you could create a composite function, or you could create a closure which is composed of two closures, in the left side I have Find Geeks by age, and right side I have Find Groovy Geeks. So the execution starts from the right side. So if you, when you invoke the closure with list of geeks, list called geeks, first Find Groovy Geeks will get called by passing the original list, which will return a filtered list, which in turn is passed into Find Geeks at least closure, and which will return the results. That's how we can compose functions. That leads to another closure. We can compose functions and reuse that combination. We have all heard immutable data is good. So let's just take a step back and look at the data we are using. I have created a list and I have continuously mutated that list, right? I'm adding new objects to geeks list thrice here. What if I want to take some immutable approach? I can use plus operator. So I say list plus and an object. You could use list plus another list as well. So in this case, the geeks 2 will have 4 objects, and geeks, which is the original list, will not be modified. What if I want to make sure that list itself is immutable? I don't want anybody to call mutating functions on list. I could say geeks.asImmutable. So now if I try to say arrow and add an object, it will give a exception. So that's how we move towards immutable data. Since Groovy is dynamically typed, that check will happen at current time. Let's take another example. Say we want to sort. By default, Groovy will reuse Java collections. And we know that Java collections are totally mutable. They don't have any immutable flavors at all. Oh, I mean, all the operations on collections are mutable. So here, I sort geeks by age. The result I assign it to a new variable. But in spite of that, you would see that both objects or both lists will have same values. The geeks list itself will get modified, which will get sorted. And the same will be assigned to geeks ordered by age, which is not we really want to do. What can we do then? So we can pass another parameter, Boolean parameter, called false, which will ensure that original list geeks is not modified. So the sorted list is present in the newly created variable, and original list is not sorted. So this is just one example I gave. What Groovy, even though Groovy uses a lot of collections functionalities, or functions from Java collection API, still it provides some pure functions alternative, wherein the original list is not modified. Instead, it will return a new list. So most of the cases, like unique and most such cases, you would see that there is also another function which takes a Boolean value, wherein you can pass false, saying that you really want you really don't want to mutate original data. Or in other words, Groovy provides some pure functions for you to work with the same set of collections. Well, let's go to a code now. Okay. As you could understand, it's a very simple program to find out the factorial of a number, and I take a recursive approach. Let me just run that. Runs fine. Okay. Now you see something is wrong here. What happened? By default, I didn't specify the type here. So by default, it took integer as the type, and the value just overflew. So I got a negative value. We can quickly fix this, say, by using long, but that too will not scale very much. So instead, I could specify g so that it uses big integer, and it gives. Now what happened?
Stack Overflow, right? This is a limitation of a recursion approach. So let's just modify this code a little bit.
Now, I have changed the code slightly. I have modified the code slightly towards optimizing for tail call optimization, wherein the last statement or the last expression in the function is a call to the original function, right? There's no multiplication or anything. How does that help is you really don't need another stack frame to compute that. That's how you, whenever you are going a recursion with the heavy demand for stack, you know, which will work without really needing so much of stack. Essentially, you avoid a stack frame. That's the optimization we could do here. Now, let me try to run this. Still, that problem is there. All the change I have done here is I have added an additional annotation called @tail_recursive. Now let me run this. So you will see that it computes factorial. That's how, wherever you need that, you really want to overcome the Stack Overflow exception limitation, you could use tail recursive, which will optimize the code for, tail call optimization. Yeah. No, right now it doesn't do that way. We'll have to explicitly say that, go and do a tail call optimization. That's the decision they have taken. They can really go and do that, but, I'm not sure people would really want to do that as the default. Even the Scala, I don't think it does that way. Automatically? You have to give it. But you have to give that, right? You don't have to give that? Okay, but that's just a design decision. So this is the code we ended up. This annotation was introduced very recently in Groovy version 2.3. So prior to 2.3, we used to do, so that's the next pressure we have, tail call optimization. And prior to Groovy 2.3, we had to use actually closure. We could not do that on a regular function. We had to do trampoline function, which does the same thing. Even if you put the annotation, it does the same. Go to the next demo. Is that okay? Okay, so you could see you have a function which is taking a lot of computing time, assume that way, even though I'm just doing a square of the number and I'm just calling the function twice. So let me run that. So it's calling performing computation and producing the same result. So whenever you have a computing intensive operations, you really don't have to call them multiple times. Instead of doing that operation multiple times, you could cache that and get the result next time. I mean, this is possible only when you have a pure function. So let me just the first time the computing did happen, and the second time it took the cached result. It really doesn't do that. That way you can optimize your code. You're writing impure function. Yes. Right. It will be just based on the parameter you pass, because Groovy will not decide whether the function is pure or impure. So unlike languages like Haskell, it doesn't really prevent you from writing impure functions. Or you don't have to say that this function is impure or something like that. That's not it. So this is the code we saw. So the next treasure is better performing code through memoized functions. All the functional programming languages have some common features. They have higher order functions for operations like map, filter, and reduce. So let's take a couple of examples here. In the first one, I'm finding all the geeks who know Groovy language, which is find all. So filter operation in Groovy is called find all. And then I'm invoking collect function. Collect function corresponds to map function in most of the languages. So I'm just getting the age of each geek. Then I'm computing the sum of those numbers, which is the age. So sum is a reducer function. Okay? There are multiple reducer functions available. In the next example, I'm just trying to get the average of the age. So I just take advantage of width function here, so that I need to get sum as well as size both on the same object. Otherwise, I'll have to assign this value to some variable and then call it twice, sort of. So through width, really, you can perform these sort of operations, in continuity. So that's sorry. No, not here. So Groovy has a library called Jeepers, which comes bundled with standard Groovy package. So you could use that to parallelize that. Or you could use Java 8 streams also. So in Java 8, you would pass lambda expression to the streams. So you could use the same stream API passing closures. That's how you could get some benefits. So let's go to the next example. So what I'm trying to do here is I'm trying to go to a website, get the content of that, right? So I have, again, a data structure called website, which has two fields, string address and the actual URL. If you know Java, URL is a very special class in Java, right? Anybody knows what is the specialty of that? URL. Yes, the speciality is that URL class requires internet to work, right? So if the internet is not working, it will not. So let me just execute that and then explain what does it do. That better? Yeah. So first time you would see that address is present, but URL is null. So since I have put et lazy annotation on that, that conversion of address to a URL or the construction of URL did not happen here because I gave et lazy. I mean, during the first case, when you would see here when I'm doing a dump. Then what I'm trying to do is, I'm trying to access the content of that website, okay, which I'm putting into a variable called content. Since the content is very large, I really don't want to print here. So instead, I print how many lines are there in that, how many new lines, characters are there, which gives me 323, I suppose. And then I call the dump again. Dump is just to inspect the object structure. So now you would see that the URL is present there. So I can minimize it a little bit. You would see that the URL is now pointing to functional content. That's how, if you really have a costly construction, you can defer it so that if the value is really used, then only you go and construct that object. Otherwise, you avoid constructing that. The code we have. So lazy evaluation is a treasure we got. This is a common kind of question when it comes to functional programming. Is recursion better or iteration? So usually we favor recursion in functional programming and say iteration is not so good. Let's take an example. The same example, I'm just collecting the ages and putting into a list called ages. Then first, the uncommented code, I'm using recursion approach to calculate the sum of numbers, sum of integers. So you would see there are method functions called het, which will return the first element, tail will return rest of the, you know, rest of the collection. So I'm using a recursive approach here to calculate the sum, and I just pass 0 as the initial value and the tail as the entire list. Let's just run it. Let me use internal iterator based using inject. Inject is similar to Scala. I have fold left. It's similar to that. So I'm just printing that. You would see. Both are producing same results. So which one is good here? If you take the first one, it uses recursion, so it could be slow, but you have the option to tail call optimize that and make it faster and come out of the stack overflow limitations. But why do we really hate iteration? It's because there is a mutation, there is a change, we are constantly changing some value, right? But if you look at this example, second example, wherein we are using internal iterator, not the external iterator, we really don't have any moving parts. We're not modifying any variable here, though internally it may use some loops. So having looked at all these examples, throughout our journey, we collected a lot of functional treasure. But what is that one common thing we saw in each and every example? We know already that object-oriented, takes the approach of encapsulating the changes, while functional programming approach takes, the approach of minimizing the moving parts. So recursion versus internal iteration, in both cases, we have been able to achieve, to write the code without having mutation or without having moving parts. So, you really don't have to rely on one. You could use either of them depending on your performance or readability, etc. So, let's just take a look back at the treasures we collected 8 of them. And we saw how this could improve your code. So if you are already a Groovy programmer and not using functional programming, this is a good time to consider functional programming because it can result in a better code. Simple code, easy to understand, less error prone. If you are a Java programmer, you could consider using Groovy because it has better capabilities for doing functional programming. But if you're already using, say, Haskell or Clojure or languages like that, and your decision is right, then I don't say that you have to come to Groovy and do coding. But if you are a language enthusiast, it's a good thing to learn functional programming or any concepts in any language. So with that, I welcome all of you to the land of functional programming in Groovy. Any questions? A code I'll check in there. Questions? Yeah, please. You're right. 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 The new list object will be created, but objects inside that will remain the same. List is immutable doesn't mean that objects inside that are immutable. You could change them. So there is not much cost associated with that. But if each one requires, you know, new object to be created, then yeah, it would be a performance issue. But mostly you would put object references there. Actually, there will be only one object in the heap, and both these lists will point to the same object. So there should not be a performance. That depends here. So in my example, I used objects, right? Geeka. Yes, it does. Because you cannot put a primitive in a list. So you have to box it and put it. Mm-hmm. Well, if you really have that concern, you can always go and create some immutable collections. You could use Guava or libraries like that. One option is there. And I showed you as immutable, right? Similarly, there is asynchronized method function on any of the collections, wherein you could create a synchronized collection, which would convert, say, Rabbit in a synchronized collection. Oh, sure. I'd be putting this in a slide share as well. Well, thank you then. I hope that was a groovier experience.